Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa Allah. Ashhadu an la أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم رب السماوات والأرض ورب العرش العظيم ربنا ورب كل شيء أعوذ بك من شر كل شيء أعوذ بك من شر كل شيء أنت آخذ بناصيته اللهم أنت الأول فليس قبلك شيء وأنت الآخر الآخر فليس بعدك شيء وأنت الظاهر فليس فوقك شيء وأنت الباطن فليس دونك شيء I have been asked, but have been suggested to me that I speak to you about Sharia. And normally, because of the enormity of the subject itself, I leave the topic and the issue of Sharia to extended lectures. But we have reached a point in our evolution as Muslims where putting the dots on the letters when it comes to Sharia has become more important than ever. قال الله في محكم آياته لا أيها الناس قد جاءكم برهان من ربكم وأنزلنا إليكم نورا مبينا الله reminds us in his book that what has come to you what has come to us human beings is nothing less than a discerning light and proof and that what has been sent to us is a differentiating light and enlightenment. وَيَقُولُ اللَّهُ فِي كِتَابِهِ الْعَزِيزِ وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ Do not just good, but the ihsan is goodness that elevates itself to the level of beauty. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ God loves those who do beauty. So, what is Sharia? Sharia cannot be separated in any way, form, or function from these essential Quranic exhortations or Quranic reminders of what Allah has given us and what Allah has entrusted to us. Sharia is part of the amana that Allah, the trust that Allah has offered to the heavens and the earth and was rejected. Sharia is also part of the kalima or the asma ul ashiya, the names of things that God taught Adam and that became material proof for the worthiness of human beings to carry the visceralship, the istikhlaf, the khilafa, the caliphate on behalf of God, not the political caliphate, but the deputyship that we all carry as human being, as human beings, for God, on behalf of God, and with it we achieve godliness. Furthermore, Sharia is inseparable from the Quranic injunction to us human beings, أن نكون عبادا ربانيون. We become godly beings. How do we get there? How do we attach Sharia to all these meanings? Well, at the most elementary and basic level, we say the Sharia, lughatan, as a matter of language, is a source, is a water hole, a path, it has a variety of meanings, but all of them connoting the ability or the process of getting from one point to another point, and with an inherent meaning, a implied meaning that you get from a worse point to a better point. So if you are going from life to death, we don't call this Sharia. But if you go from a path of death to life, then you are taking a path of Sharia. That's just in language. And if you bring yourself or your animals or whatever to something that brings them life, you bring them to Sharia. But if you bring them to something that causes them death, then you cannot say, I bring them to Sharia, but you say, I bring them to Jaffa, or I bring them to Al-Bala, or whatever other expressions that are intended. The Quran uses Sharia, uses the word Sharia not exclusively to the paths ordained to Muslims, but it also talks about Shara' al-Yahud, the paths ordained to Jews, and the paths ordained to other nations. But fundamentally, it is always the same concept. It is the basic notion of something from God and to God, something that emanates from God and returns to God. Now, we have reached a day and age where many of us forgot the basic framework upon which the very idea of Sharia was constructed, and its very essence in which it played in Islamic faith, to the point that we've reached a day and age that Muslims have, many Muslims, the very concept of Sharia raises fear in them and raises a level of repulsion. Some have even said that we can do with Islam but we don't need Sharia. Some have even said that, or the group known as the Quraniyun, that we need only the Quran but we don't need either the Sunnah or Hadith or Sharia. But if you accept with me for the time being that Sharia is inseparable from the notion of nur, light that had been sent to people, and that the logical assumption that if Sharia is truly a light and enlightenment from God, then it is also necessarily what God loves and what God, and it contains a discernment between what God loves and what God does not love. And what we ask then, well, what is it that God loves? And here the Quran has an extensive list of Inna Allah yuhibbul muhsinin, God loves those who do perform duty. Inna Allah yuhibbul muqsitin, God loves those who do justice. Inna Allah yuhibbul, or Inna Allah la yuhibbul dhalimin, God does not love those who do injustice. Inna Allah yuhibbul islah, God loves the commission or the performance of goodness. Inna Allah la yuhibbul mufsidin, God doesn't love the commission of corruption. These are the ethics, the ideals. And this is why the early jurists, when they try to sum up the idea of Sharia, they would say, "Al-Sharia hiya ma waqaf alayha masalih al-ibad." Sharia is what, it's summing it up in a sort of catechism way, that Sharia is whatever is necessary for the well-being of human beings, with the assumption that whatever entails the well-being of human beings cannot but be but part of the light and enlightenment that God has sent. And in addition to that, part of the catechism was كُلُّ مَا خَرَجَ مِنَ الْعَدْلِ إِلَى الظُّلْمِ وَكُلُّ مَا خَرَجَ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ إِلَى الْبَغْيِ وَكُلُّ مَا خَرَجَ مِنْ كُلُّ مَا خَرَجَ أَوْ كُلُّ مَا صَارَ حَرَجٌ أَوْ ضَرَرٌ وَكُلُّ شَيْءٍ everything that has deviated from justice to injustice, it cannot be Sharia. Everything that deviated from ease to hardship, it cannot be Sharia. Everything that causes agony or hardship cannot be Sharia. These are the ideological basic foundations of the whole notion of Sharia. And that is why it cannot be separated from the very notion of al-aqidah. Because if you assume, as we must, that Allah is Rahman Rahim, that Allah is just and merciful, then this God, this Allah, has to be interested in the well-being of what God has created. It cannot be that God creates human beings, gives them a heavy deputyship, a heavy viceroyship, endows them with this great power, which I could elaborate on in the lecture tonight, the power of al-asma, the names of things, and even more in this metaphorical sense has the universe prostrate to them. But then after all of that, God basically loses interest in what God has created. It cannot be. A merciful God would continue to be engaged with what God has created till the end. And that engagement of God is what they called luzum al-adl, or luzum al-rahmah, or luzum al-ihsan, or luzum al-husn, is from what necessitates that God would decree, would ordain mercy for people, ordain justice for people, ordain well-being for people. In other words, that this God would not be neutral with people suffering, that this God would not be neutral with people suffering injustice, that this God would not be neutral towards jabarut, oppression and despotism, that this God would not be neutral towards pain or agony, that this God would have a normative position in the language of theology means a position which necessitates an obligation, a taklif, that a position in which God then creates a taklif, an obligation for human beings to pursue the principles of goodness and to resist the principles that are opposite of goodness. This is what they simply call al-amr bil-ma'ruf wa nahy an al-munkar. The whole idea of al-amr bil-ma'ruf wa nahy an al-munkar, it was a basic principle upon which Sharia was constructed. This basic principle in Western countries, especially in the thinking of great intellects like Thomas Aquinas, who was a Christian theologian, who utilized and as an honest man, he freely admitted to the fact that he had read al-Ghazali and that he read Ibn Sina and Ibn Rushd and that he read Ibn Bajjah and Ibn Tufayl, and in his Summa he refers to these thinkers repeatedly. And from that, following the same system of thought, extracts the basic idea of the duty to do good and the duty to avoid what is not good. This becomes, through a series of intellectual developments, what we know as the idea of natural law, and eventually natural law mutates into natural rights. The idea of which was the American Constitution was based on, for instance. Some of you would say, well, what does natural rights have to do with rights in the Islamic context? In the Islamic context, they were able to explore the idea of obligations owed to God and obligations owed to people was pre-Islamic. It was expressed even by the Jewish philosopher Philo, for instance, or Philo. But what Muslims, from that same basic notion of dedication to a legislating God, a God that cares, reached the idea of the rights of people and the rights of God, and the rights that are shared between people and between God. This intellectually, ethically, was a breakthrough in human thought. It was a great point of enlightenment for humanity. But unfortunately, what follows in the age of modernity, what follows after the developmental period of Islamic law and of Sharia law, without a doubt, and it's something that we must admit, becomes a narrative of disappointments and missed opportunities and failed efforts for a variety of reasons. نسأل الله يستجب لكم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم ألهمنا نورا معلما وفهما ساطعا وبيانا قاطعا The famous Rumi reports about his teacher Shamsuddin, whether it's from Rumi or Shamsuddin is irrelevant. That Sharia, and it's an image that I like, Sharia is like a lantern of shining light that a person holds and walks through the dark to get from one point to another point. But what do you do if the holder of the lantern, of that light, is blind? What do you do when this light is deposited in the hands of someone, using Quranic language, whose heart, that if we assume that the heart can see as the Quran often metaphorically refers, is a blind person? Or put differently, Sharia is like a boat in an ocean that, if steered correctly and used with great degree of responsibility, can prove the instrument of livelihood. But what do you do if the sailor of that boat is blind or ignorant? Knows nothing about navigation, knows nothing about the first things of how to navigate or deal or negotiate with winds and sea. Sharia, in its most basic essence, are ethics and morals of al-husn, of goodness, or in the language of al-usuliyun, of beauty. And in its essence, it is the act of avoidance of qubh, to steer away from ugliness. But the word, and again, those of you who want to know much more about this, perhaps you can attend tonight, because impossible to do anything but just flag issues in a khutbah. The word or the names of things, for a variety of reasons, is like the consciousness of human beings. Human beings do not just evolve materially, they evolve neurologically. God has made us so that our perceptions, our understandings, our conceptions of what is ugly and beauty, some of it is permanent and unchanging, but much of it is contingent and subject to exigencies and to various contextual elements. A person who has been raised with the assumption or the use of time that comes from the use of electronics and motors and even to the point of knowledge becoming at their fingertip by the press of a button is entirely different than a person who's raised in cultures where 90% was illiterate, and among the literate, occasionally you will be able to afford to buy one or two books in your life. And if you wanted to live near a glorious library like the Library of Baghdad, you needed to relocate, or the library, the now destroyed library of Timbuktu, you needed to relocate to be a mulazim, to be living literally next to the library, and even then, your whole world of consciousness is contingent on your ability to find text with readable calligraphy as opposed to calligraphy written by far more poorer and modest copyists of texts. In other words, our very neurological makeup changes. And if our neurology changes and our capacity as human beings to endure and our physiology changes, if our thinking about what is husn and what is qubh, what is good and what is bad, does not keep up, then the whole equation, the whole tawazun, the whole balance that sustains the light that comes from God will be shaded. That light will be blocked because our receptors, our neurological receptors, have lost the ability to understand it. And that is why, my brothers and sisters, it's a great tragedy when we give up on the project of absorbing and understanding Sharia. Because we give up on nothing less, and then we often abandon the process of understanding Sharia to people who are ignorant and people who are ill-equipped and people who are often blind of heart, people who basically, even the bottom feeders of society, so instead of the smarter of us and the most ethical of us heading to the study of Sharia, it becomes the losers in society are the ones that go specialize in Sharia. That is a huge disaster, because then the light shines from God, the ihsan and the adl, and all the principles upon which we are obligated to achieve, but a shield has come up between us and that light no longer translates into a system of life that can be meaningful or that can guide us to anything. Wallahu a'lam. اللهم الهمنا علما لا يفنى اللهم نعوذ بك من علما لا ينفع اللهم نعوذ بك من الجهل وظلم الجاهلين وطغيان الظالمين اللهم اهدنا واصلح حالنا واصلح أمة الإسلام يا رب العالمين واغفر ذنوبنا وادخلنا جناتك ولا تعذبنا بما اقترفنا يا الله أقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر.